So all there is this. There is no guru, there is no seeker, there's no creation, there's no destiny, there's no journey, there's nothing to find. All there is this, and this is aliveness. Simply aliveness, apparently happening. Existence apparently happening. And this aliveness is happening to no one. Sounds happen. Walking happens. Seeing happens. Seeing is simply happening. Images arise and are seen. Breathing is happening. Another noise is happening. Blood is coursing through the body, yes? Blood. All of it is simply arising. It's simply happening, apparently. But nobody is doing it. Nobody's doing noises. Nobody's doing seeing. It can't be taught. I can't teach you. No, who can teach you to breathe? Who needs to teach you to breathe? Who can teach you to make the blood run through your body? Who can teach? Who needs to teach you to see? Seeing simply happens. Everything that happens doesn't have to be achieved. It just happens. In the next 3 or 4 hours, you're going to move and ask questions and breathe and drink coffee. It's just going to happen. And the strange thing is, it's not happening to anyone. This is the strange thing. In the appearance, out of nothing, arises the story of me. The moment the thought, I am a separate person, arises. That's the game. And then we fall into the idea that we are definitely separate people in a world that we have to negotiate with. A world that's out there that's separate, that we have to deal with. And somehow find our way through. And we're taught by our parents and by teachers and by priests or whatever. This is the way you have to be, this is the way you have to behave to succeed in the world, in very simple terms, succeed in the world, in whatever way that could be. So we all learn, we all become absolutely sure that we are separate individuals, and in order to get what we want, what we think we want, we have to make an effort. And in order to obtain what we think we need to make us happy, then we can choose this or that. We can definitely choose this or that. We do it all the time. I'm quite sure I'm an individual and I choose this or that. And that one's the right choice and that one's the wrong choice, maybe. It's all very, very difficult because although we learn that we have to succeed and do better and become better at whatever it is we're doing, it's actually quite difficult because, of course, it can fall apart. You know, all our efforts can be completely blown apart in 2 minutes by some event. But when somehow, even if we do succeed in certain things, when we get to somewhere where we think success is, it's never fulfilling. It's never whole. It's all right for a while. You know, the fast car and the three blondes and all that, it's great. But somewhere it's very transitory and it doesn't fulfill. And so some of us look further, we begin to look beyond achievement and beyond getting things. And some of us end up by finding out that there's something called enlightenment. And so we go, we hear about some guy who is a so-called master, who will teach us to become enlightened. And now somehow this rings a bell, because maybe enlightenment is the answer. Maybe enlightenment is so beyond all this achieving, that we can finally find that wholeness that we long for. But, so we go to a teacher of enlightenment, and again what we find actually is like going to school and going to the new job and all, and also especially being married to someone, we're continually being told how we should be. Even in enlightenment we get a list of things that we need to do in order to get enlightened. So again, the message is the message of speaking to an actual person, an apparent person, a separate person, who can choose this or that. By choosing this or that, they can get something. Previously to that, there's certainly a sense that if you make an effort, you get something. It seems to be like that. So we really fully also believe that if we meditate or self-inquire or destroy the ego, whatever that is, if we drop desire, that's the worst one of all, dropping desire. If we can do those things, then somehow we will get something. Because that's how it seemed to work before. But this is where we meet ignorance. This is where we meet the real ignorance. This is where we meet the teaching of imprisonment. Because the teaching of imprisonment is that I am enlightened, you can become enlightened. You are a separate person that can become enlightened. So if you do this and this and this, then you'll become enlightened. This is the teaching of imprisonment. It imprisons us in the treadmill, the prison of separate individuality with choice. And we go on and on, we can go on and on for years eating rice and meditating in caves and nothing happens simply because we are trying to become enlightened. There is no such thing as an enlightened person. There never has been. No person has ever become enlightened. Because the whole idea of a person becoming enlightened is a total contradiction, it's a total ignorance. Awakening is the realization that there is no one. When the seeker drops away, there that which is sought becomes apparent. But it becomes apparent to no one. It just is apparent. Because of course, it never came and it never went away. That which we seek is always present, is totally constant. That which we long for is already this. It just sits and watches us rushing around looking for it. The imaginary us. It is oneness. It is aliveness. It's nothing like the picture we have, or the picture we're presented with about enlightenment. We are, the mind has an idea of what enlightenment is like. It's very beautiful and very still, and all-seeing and all-knowing. All problems are no more exist. You know, there's no anger. There's just a lovely sort of fluffy, gorgeous. This is the idea. But when awakening happens, it's a total surprise. It's a total surprise to that which still has an idea of what it was going to be like. Awakening is totally natural and totally ordinary. Oneness, aliveness is totally natural, totally ordinary, and wonderful. Far more wonderful than this thing here can ever imagine. This thing here has got such a silly idea of what enlightenment or awakening is. But when awakening is seen by no one, it's realized that that liberty, that freedom, the nature of natural seeing is just so colossal. It's boundless. It's boundless freedom. Everything arises in boundless freedom. It's falling in love with this. we walk around this, walking around simply in love with this, with whatever is. It's we found at last, well, we haven't found, when we are no more, what is found is the perfect lover. The perfect lover who never leaves, never judges, totally is the expression of unconditional love in everything. And the aliveness that I speak about is the aliveness of emptiness and fullness, of nothing and everything. This is the nature of radical aliveness. It comes out of source, it comes out of nothing, and it is nothing appearing as everything. So there's a different fullness in it. It's a wholeness that we can't see all the time that we are something, an individual. All the time that we are an individual, we don't see clearly. We see through a veil. And when we look, we look with the eyes of a businessman. Because somewhere, when we look at things as separate individuals, we either look to protect ourselves from what is seen, or to get something from that which is seen. We don't look as lovers. We don't look as lovers. We look as business people. That's natural. There's nothing right or wrong with that. That's the way it is. That's the game that oneness plays, pretending to be two, pretending to be fine, pretending to be greedy. That's the game. There's nothing right or wrong with it. That's the way it is. And then afterwards, when there is no one, what is seen uncluttered, just what it is, the expression of unconditional love.